Hello everyone, I am Shyam Sudhakar, faculty in Dynamics of Machines. In this video, I am going to explain about the introduction about the mechanical vibrations.
Introduction. Elastic bodies such as a spring, a beam, a shaft are displaced from the equilibrium position by the application of external forces and then released. They execute a vibratory motion. Examples for vibrations in our daily life: locomotives, cars, machines, earthquakes, and in musical instruments. Reasons for vibrations. When a body is displaced, the internal forces in the form of elastic or strain energy are present in the body. At release, these forces bring the body to its original position. When the body reaches the equilibrium position, the whole of the elastic or strain energy is converted into kinetic energy. Due to this kinetic energy, the body continues to move in the opposite direction. The whole of the kinetic energy is again converted into strain energy. And due to this strain energy, the body again returns to the equilibrium position. In this way, the vibratory motion is repeated indefinitely. The next question is, when vibrations occur? Vibration problems occur where there are rotating or moving parts in a machinery. Apart from the machinery itself, the surrounding structure also faces the vibration hazard because of this vibrating machinery. For example, in locomotives. Similarly, second example, diesel engines mounted on unsound foundations. Third example, whirling of shafts. Causes of vibrations. There are so many causes of vibrations. Out of these causes, here I am explaining some of the causes. First one, unbalanced forces in the machine produced from within the machine itself. Second one, dry friction between the two mating surfaces. Therefore, self-excited vibration produced. Third one, external excitations. These excitations may be periodic, random, or the nature of an impact produced external to the vibrating system. And the fourth one, earthquakes. Earthquakes are responsible for the failure of many buildings, dams, etc. And fifth one, winds. Winds are caused the vibration of transmission and a telephone line under certain conditions. Next one, the effects of vibrations. The effects of vibrations include both the useful effects as well as harmful effects. Coming to the useful effects, these vibrations are useful in concrete compactor, pile drivers, ultrasonic cleaning baths. Similarly, in musical instruments, in vibrating screens to separate the feed from the solid, in mineral processing industries, it is very much useful. Similarly, in shakers and also in stress relieving instruments like massage instruments, these are very, very useful. Second one, harmful effects. Due to vibrations, there are so many harmful effects. First one is, excessive stresses are formed within the machine elements. That is the first one. Second one, undesirable noise is produced. And the third one, looseness of part and partial or complete failure of the part. If you observe in the figure, in fans, a lot of noise is produced due to these vibrations. Similarly, sometimes destruction is also occur in machines.
And also, wear and fatigue is the major problem with the harmful effect of the vibrations. Next one, how to eliminate or reduce the undesirable vibrations? This is our major problem. There are some methods to eliminate or reduce undesirable vibrations. These methods are, first one, removing the causes of vibrations. Whatever the cause of the vibration present, we have to remove it, whether it is unbalanced forces or dry friction or external excitations or earthquakes or winds. We have to remove the cause of the vibration. That is the first one. Second one is putting the screens if noise is objectionable. For example, in recording theaters, by placing more screens, we can remove the echo. We can remove the echo due to the vibrations. And third one, placing the machinery on proper isolatory. That is very, very important in our machine shops. Fourth one, using shock absorbers, then we can remove or we can reduce the vibrations. And fifth one, using dynamic vibration absorbers. These are some methods to eliminate or reduce the undesirable vibrations. If we plan proper design, there is possibility of the avoidance of vibration problems at a very low cost. Before we are going to the main topic, let us discuss some important definitions. First one, periodic motion. Periodic motion is defined as a motion which repeats itself after equal intervals of time. Second one, time period. It is the time taken to complete one cycle is called time period. Third one, cycle. The motion completed during one time period is called cycle. Fourth one, frequency. Number of cycles per unit time is called frequency. The unit of frequency is hertz. One hertz is equal to one cycle per second. Fifth one, amplitude of motion. Amplitude of motion is defined as the maximum displacement of a vibrating body from the mean position. And sixth one, phase angle. It is the angle by which one vibrating system is ahead or behind the other vibrating system is known as phase angle. Types of vibrations. Basically, there are three important types in vibrations. First one is free or natural vibration. Second one is forced vibrations. And the third one is damped vibrations. Let us discuss all the three vibrations one by one. First one, free or natural vibration. When no external force acts on the body after giving some initial displacement, then the body is said to be under free or natural vibrations. In these vibrations, the vibrations of a system is because of its own elastic properties. And amplitude and frequency of a free vibrating body remains constant. Examples, simple pendulum, notes of musical instruments, organ pipe, oscillations of object connected to horizontal spring, sound produced by a tuning fork in short distances. Definition of free or natural frequency. Free or natural frequency is defined as the frequency of free vibration of the system. This is constant for a given system. Next one, forced vibration. when the body vibrates under the influence of external force, then the body is said to be under forced vibrations. The frequency of vibration is the same as that of the applied force. Examples: pendulum in clock. Vibration of floor caused by running of heavy machinery. Vibration of car when running in an uneven road surface. Vibration in reciprocating engines due to periodic reciprocation of piston. These are all examples of forced vibration. Next topic, resonance. The vibration of the system when the frequency of the external force is equal to the natural frequency of the system, then the resonance occurs. The amplitude of vibration at resonance becomes excessive. Third type of vibrations, damped vibrations. When there is a reduction in amplitude over every cycle of vibration, then the motion is said to be damped vibration. Damping means resistance to the motion of the vibrating body. Example for damped vibrations: oscillations of a branch of tree. Similarly, sound produced by tuning fork over long distances. These are the examples of damped vibrations. Next one, it is very important topic, which is called degree of freedom. A system is said to be n degree of freedom if it needs n independent coordinates to specify completely the configuration of the system at any instant. Simply, we can define degree of freedom like this: the number of independent relative motions, both translational as well as rotational, a pair can have. This is the definition of degree of freedom. In general, a body in space having 6 number of degree of freedom. Suppose there are some constraints, then the degree of freedom is equal to 6 minus number of constraints. Now let us see some examples of degree of freedom. A single degree of freedom systems. In the first figure, the pendulum is having only one independent motion, that is rotatory motion about y-axis at an angle of theta. So it is having only one degree of freedom. Similarly, in the second figure, it is a slider crank spring mechanism in which the crank can move only rotatory motion along one direction. So it is having a single degree of freedom. There are two more examples are shown in this figure. In the first figure, a mass M is attached to a spring, which is a spring mass system. The mass M is having a single independent relative motion, that is towards right or left, that is a translatory motion. Therefore, it is a single degree of freedom system. Similarly, in the second figure, a torsional system is shown in which a disc is attached to the shaft. The disc is having a single independent relative motion, that is rotatory motion, at an angle of theta. Therefore, it is also a single degree of freedom system. Now let us see the examples for 2 degrees of freedom systems. In this figure, there are two masses, M1 and M2, are attached to each other by means of two springs. Mass 1 is having one independent relative motion, that is translatory. Similarly, mass 2 is also having one independent relative motion that is also translatory. Therefore, this is the example for 2 degree of freedom system. Let us see one more example for 2 degrees of freedom system. In this example, two rotors are attached to a shaft. These two rotors having two independent relative motions, that is rotatory motion. Therefore, it is an example for 2 degrees of freedom systems. One more example is shown in this figure. In this figure, the mass m is having translatory motion. Similarly, the length l is having rotatory motion. Therefore, two independent relative motions exist. Therefore, this system is an example of 2 degrees of freedom. Now let us see examples for 3 degrees of freedom systems. This is first example. This is the second example. And this is the third example. Next, let us see an example for 6 degrees of freedom system. In this figure, a body is having 3 translatory motions along x-axis, y-axis and z-axis, as well as 3 rotatory motions about x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. Therefore, the degree of freedom of this system is 6. Next one, infinite degrees of freedom systems. The best example is a cantilever subjected to a load at its free end. When a cantilever is subjected to a load at free end, it is having some displacement. The particles on the cantilever having different displacements. Example, x1, x2, x3. So they are having different independent motions. Therefore, it is an example of infinite degrees of freedom systems. So far, we have seen the classification of the vibrations, free vibrations, forced vibrations, and damped vibrations. Now let us see what are different types of free vibrations. Free vibrations are classified into 3 categories. First one, longitudinal vibrations. Second one, transverse vibrations. And third one, torsional vibrations. Let us discuss one by one. First one is longitudinal vibrations. In longitudinal vibrations, the particles of the shaft or disc move parallel to the axis of the shaft. Just see in the figure, the disc initial position is at B. When there is elongation, the particles on B will move to the C position. Similarly, when there is shortened, then the particles on B will move to A position. In these two positions are parallel to the axis of the shaft. Shaft is elongated and shortened alternatively. In longitudinal vibrations, tensile and compressive stresses induced alternatively in the shaft. Second one is transverse vibrations. In transverse vibrations, the particles of the shaft or disc move approximately perpendicular to the axis of the shaft. Just see in the figure, B position is mean position, A and C positions are extreme positions. So, the particles on the shaft move approximately perpendicular when they are moved to C and A positions. Shaft is straight and bent alternatively. In transverse vibrations, bending stresses are induced in the shaft. And third one is torsional vibrations. In torsional vibrations, the particles of the shaft or disc move in a circle about the axis of the shaft. Example is shown in the figure. The mean position is B and the extreme positions are A and C. That means the particles move in a circle about the axis of the shaft.
The shaft is twisted and untwisted alternatively. In torsional vibrations, torsional shear stresses are induced in the shaft. Now let us define a simple harmonic motion. In simple harmonic motion, the acceleration of a body is directly proportional to the displacement from the mean position and is always directed towards the mean position. A simple harmonic motion is generally represented by displacement x is equal capital A sine omega t, where capital A is amplitude of motion and omega is angular velocity of motion and time t is time taken for the vibration. Now velocity v is derivative of x with respect to t. Dx by dt is equal A omega cos omega t. Once again, if you differentiate, the acceleration A is equal x double dot is equal to d square x by dt square, which is equal to minus A omega square into sine omega t, which is equal to minus omega square into x. Therefore, acceleration is directly proportional to the displacement. The minus sign indicates its direction is towards mean position. Our next topic is equivalent stiffness of springs. If springs are in series, suppose two springs having constants K1 and K2 are in series. Stiffness of spring 1 is K1. Stiffness of spring 2 is K2. Extension of spring 1 is X1 and extension of spring 2 is X2. Force in spring 1 is equal to force in spring 2. Force in spring 1 is K1 into X1. Force in spring 2 is equal to K2 X2. Here the total extension x by two strings is equal to extension in spring 1 plus extension in spring 2, that is x1 plus x2, that is equal f by k1 plus f by k2. Therefore, the equivalent stiffness ke is equal f by x. Substitute the value of x in this equation. You will get KE is equal 1 by K1 plus 1 by K2, which is equal to K1 K2 by K1 plus K2, or 1 by KE is equal 1 by K1 plus 1 by K2. In general, for a springs, N springs in series, 1 by KE is equal sigma I is equal 1 to N 1 by KI. Second case, if springs are in parallel, stiffness of first spring is K1, stiffness of second spring is K2, and the extensions are same in both the springs. Extension of spring 1 is X, extension of spring 2 also X. Force in first spring F1 is equal K1 into X. Force in second spring is equal to K2 into X. This force is distributed among two springs in their ratio. The total force F is equal F1 plus F2. That is equal K1X plus K2X. Therefore, equivalent stiffness KE is equal F by X. By substituting the value of X in this equation, which is equal to K1 plus K2. In general, if N springs are in parallel, then KE is equal sigma I is equal 1 to N KI,